over the crowd. I guess I'll leave you. Good morning again. Welcome, everybody, to the Carol Chamber Annual State of the County Meeting. Thank you for joining us today. The county members represent over 200 people in attendance this morning. Thank you. My name is Mike Fox. I'm with Lehigh Cement, and I've had the privilege of serving as the Chamber's Chair of the Board for 2014. This will be my last official meeting as the chair. As we pass the gavel later during the meeting to Lori Blake, she'll take over in 2015, and she's the Director of HR for Fuchs North America. I'd like to take just a minute to say thanks to a few people. This past year's been a great year as chairperson of the Chamber Board. First of all, I'd like to thank Lehigh Cement, and in particular Kent Martin. Kent's out there somewhere, for making it possible for me to be flexible with my schedule to attend a chamber events. There's probably two or three a month that take the time as chairperson. And Kent, thank you very much. I appreciate that. Thanks. And to Mike McMullen, thank you so much for what you do for our Carroll County Chamber. I've learned after serving on several boards that when a CEO or president is passionate about the mission of an organization, that organization is extremely successful. Mike is no exception to that rule. Through his passionate leadership, the Chamber continues to create relationships for businesses in this, its 90th year of doing business in Carroll County, serving Carroll County, and membership continues to grow over 500. Partnerships continue to be explored, and networking opportunities for the Carroll County businesses get explored and created every year. It's been a real pleasure to serve on the board. Thank you, Mike, for all you do. Great job. Thanks. And as always, just a gentle reminder, if you have your cell phones, please put those to vibrator silent. I left mine in the truck just so I didn't have a problem. Got a number of introductions to start this morning. I'd like to thank our Board of County Commissioners for being with us today. Please stand when your name is called. Commissioner Steve Wantz, District 1. Commissioner Richard Weaver, District 2. Commissioner Dennis Frazier, District 3. Commissioner Richard Rothschild, District 4. And Commissioner Doug Howard, District 5. We have several other elected officials with us today, and I'd like to recognize them. Mayor Jim McCarron, City of Taneytown. Mayor Kevin Utz, City of Westminster. Mayor Neil Roop, Town of New Windsor. Mayor Perry Jones, Union Bridge. State's Attorney Brian DiLeonardo. Delegate Trent Kittleman. And Carroll County Sheriff Jim DeWeese. A few of you snuck in here on us this morning, so have I missed anybody? Oh, thank you. From the Board of Education, Carroll County, Jim Doolin, President of the Board. Virginia Harrison. Devin Rothschild. And Bob Lord. And Superintendent of Carroll County Public Schools, Stephen Guthrie. There are several former chairpersons of the board here with us this morning. As I call your name, please stand. Ellen Finnerty Myers, Carroll Hospital Center Foundation. Is Ellen here this morning? Christine Walters, 5L Company. Dave Ballinger, Barnes Ballinger Insurance. Mike Schenck, M&T Bank. Wayne Barnes, Wayne Barnes Life and Long-Term Care. An immediate past chair who I am excited to be that title here in a few minutes, Steve Wantz, Carroll County College Foundation. I saw several of you, if you're on the current board, please stand and be recognized. There's several of you here this morning. Thank you. I'm sorry? Past chair, Steve Aquino, sorry, Aquino Financial Group. He's one of those that snuck in on us this morning. Sorry, Steve. I'd like to ask the members of the Leadership Carroll Class of 2015 to stand and be recognized. You're all right there in the center. Leadership Carroll is a partner program of the Carroll County Chamber of Commerce and Carroll Community College. It is a 10-month program in which existing and emerging community leaders participate in valuable training and networking activities all over the county. This outstanding program has been in existence for almost 25 years, and if you would like to be part of next year's class, which starts in September of this year, please contact the chamber office or fill out an application, which is on the chamber's website. This year's program is being held here in the beautiful Carroll Arts Center. We'd like to express our appreciation to Sandy Ox, Executive Director of the Carroll Arts Council, for making this theater available to us. Please join me in welcoming Sandy Ox to the microphone.
Good morning, and welcome to the Carroll Arts Center. We are celebrating our 12th anniversary in this magnificent facility, and I never want to pass up an opportunity to thank our Mayor Kevin Utz and our City Administrator Marge Wolf for the wonderful investment they have made in the arts. Those of us who work in the arts, we tend to work at night a lot, so you'll have to forgive me. I'm half asleep. I'm sort of hoping that some of you are half asleep, because I was thinking I could just use my welcoming remarks from last year. Show of hands, does anybody remember them? Okay. Show of hands, does anyone remember Commissioner Robin Frazier's remarks? Need I say more about the power of the arts? All kidding aside, it's true. The arts can, I'll give you a minute there. Okay. The arts can entertain, educate, and enlighten, and the arts are one of the most effective economic drivers in our communities. The arts mean business, and I hope that each and every one of you uses our success to retain good employees and attract new customers. By sponsoring events here, you can reach an audience of over 40,000 annual visitors, and you can spread your message about what you do. Our supporters are equally as important as the musicians, actors, and dancers who grace our stage. They provide the solid foundation for what we do, and we are very grateful for your support. If you're not a current member, please grab a brochure on your way out. In closing, I truly hope that one of the commissioners will break into song. But in case they don't, we have some wonderful music coming up here this spring. We've got a Dixieland swing band here on Valentine's Day. We have the ever-popular Barley Juice, Celtic Rock coming. We have Victoria Vox, who's a ukulele master. We have a professional production of The Elephant Man. We have Thomas Pandolfi, who is an extraordinary classical pianist, and we have the Eric Bird Trio returning, not with a Charlie Brown tree, but with a full section of horns doing a tribute to Ray Charles. So there's some great stuff happening here on this stage, even if the commissioners don't sing this year. And I thank you for coming. Enjoy your day.
Thank you, Sandy. Our sponsors are very important to us and allow us to offer events like this to our members and the community. Today's corporate sponsor is M&T Bank. Our sponsor's message today will be delivered by Mark Blackston, M&T Vice President and Team Leader for Carroll and Frederick Counties. Mark?
Thank you and good morning. That's a tough act to follow, Sandy. I would break out in song, but I'm a little hoarse this morning. But thank you for the warm introduction, and again, thanks to the Carroll Arts Council. This is really a great venue for this, and I just really want to give another round of applause for them for us to do this every year. I'd also like to offer my sincere congratulations to our re-elected commissioners Howard and Rothschild and our newly elected commissioners Frazier, Wantz, and Weaver, and wishing each of them much success in their leadership roles. Congratulations. On behalf of M&T, we are honored to continue our partnership with the Carroll County Chamber of Commerce as sponsor of this annual State of the County Address, and we appreciate the opportunity to say a few words here. But look, I realize there are many people that need to speak today, so I'm going to keep this very brief. It's okay to applaud because I said brief. M&T Bank's mission is straightforward. We're here to help you succeed, plain and simple. Despite popular belief, it's really not just about a checking account, a business loan, a home equity, or web banking. That's all boring stuff. At M&T, it's about getting to know you, it's about getting to know your story, it's about understanding where you want to go today, and most importantly, where you want to be tomorrow. Simply put, we'd like to be with you where you go tomorrow. My colleagues Dave, Mike, Michelle, Linda, David, Joe, and Renee will be here after today's address, and we'd love the opportunity to meet you. Thank you all, and enjoy the address.
Thank you, Mark, for your comments and your support for the chamber. It wouldn't be a chamber program if I didn't say this. I don't know how many times I've said this today, but if you are interested in sponsoring a chamber event in 2015, please see Mike McMullen before leaving today, as there are sponsorship opportunities available. That part I almost know by heart. Now, let us begin our program. The Carroll County Chamber of Commerce is pleased to present the 2015 State of the County Address. Our commissioners will each briefly speak, and then they will be available for questions afterwards. We will hear from them in district order. Representing District 1 and serving as Vice President of the Board, Commissioner Stephen Wentz.
Okay. I was going to stay here.
Thank you and good morning. Sandy sort of broke the ice. If I had a dollar for every time that someone has asked me over the last several months if this event today would be my singing debut, I could walk away a rich man here this morning. But no, I will not be singing to you this morning. I would like to first thank the Chamber for their hospitality. I want to welcome our business community, the leadership class, and the citizens who are present here today for this address. It is an honor to be addressing you for the first time as your county commissioner. And for the record, brief is not in my vocabulary. One of the great things about being from District 1 is that I get to go first. And I'm excited about that, and I'm excited about coming out of the gate here with my two other commissioners working with our two incumbents. We are truly excited to bring you our governing principles and how we are going to move forward here. And the other thing I would like to mention is by the time we get to that other end of the table, due to the early morning hours, I would think that you would be nodding off, so you'll pay attention to what I have to say. I've had many leadership positions, but the first month in office has been interesting and exciting and eye-opening for sure. There is a lot of work to be done. It has been a privilege to get to know our department heads and county staff. And trust me when I tell you, we have a valuable, experienced, impressive staff. There are never enough funds to do everything we need to do, and we certainly need to attract additional state and federal resources. But we must make needed community investments. I expect all departments, town and city officials, and partners to use practices of excellence and initiative to accomplish our goals. As I look ahead to the upcoming challenges which lie before us, I am excited at the prospect of moving forward to improve our vital communities where we want our citizens to live, work, and play. There are many areas of concern as I outlined during my campaign in the last 2 years. My plan is to concentrate on some areas that will provide a quality of life that is sustainable for our citizens while being the best steward of tax dollars. I'm labeling this plan as the 3E plan: education, economic development, and emergency services. Bringing these components together helps ensure we are a model community and enjoy all Carroll County has to offer. We need to think big and make wise investments to achieve our vision for the highest quality services we can offer. The first E, education. Education is the cornerstone of success for any community. We built a world-class public school system in Carroll County, and our schools have collaborated with our communities, libraries, businesses, and our community college, coming together as partners. We must fund our school system needs, including staff salaries and needed resources, to be able to provide a high level of support for our students, to give them the knowledge base and skill to take us into the future. In reality, companies locate in areas that provide an excellent school system, delivering an educated and skilled workforce. We, as community leaders, must ensure that our schools have the resources to adequately prepare our students for college, employment, and life. We are raising children in a world where new technologies are being deployed at lightning speed. I must sometimes rely on my daughters and now my grandchildren to assist me with the latest technology, the essential apps, or help with the cloud. And yes, I thought a cloud was simply a blockage of the sun or something that contained rain, but apparently it holds all kinds of information in the sky. Keeping up with technology changes and adapting our workforce to apply them is critical to ensure we meet the needs of our companies, small business community, and also attract new business to our county. So, we have a prepared workforce. What else will help ensure we attract new business? The second E, economic development. First impressions are critical. Carroll County must offer a welcoming business climate. We start by addressing the above education needs, and there are a variety of other ways, without sacrificing the building blocks that make up our quality of life as we know it, including our heritage of ag preservation, parks, and recreation areas to grow our economy. Ensuring that properly zoned properties have the necessary infrastructure to support business operations is crucial. This was envisioned years ago with the inception of our Carroll County Public Network System. The county has been working hard to expand and provide a high-speed broadband network countywide in a growing digital age. When I graduated from high school 30-plus years ago, there were 4 billion people in the world, and a quarter of them were connected. Today, there are 7-plus billion people in the world, and 5 billion are connected. Carroll County, the city of Westminster, continue to make major investments to build an information highway that meets business needs not just today, but for the future. We must continue to streamline our permit process also. I had the opportunity before being elected to work with a group concentrating on this very issue. Time is of essence when relocating or building a new facility. We must have a user-friendly process in place. As a 30-plus year small business owner, I know we must help small business. Carroll County provides valuable resources to enhance this experience. Carroll Business Path, which is comprised of 5 community partners, including our Carroll County Chamber of Commerce, the Carroll County Small Business Loan, the Know Before You Go program, our Carroll County Downtown Main Street communities, and our recent Carroll Innovation Center at Overton. Over the past 10 years, companies with less than 500 employees created 40% of all new jobs. Expansion of existing companies created the remaining 60%. I am excited for the arrival of Fuchs to our North Carroll Business Park, the recent location of Carlisle, etc., and the expansion of one of our flagship businesses, Penguin Random House. And the final E, but certainly not the least, is emergency services. Working as a partner with our new sheriff, Jim DeWeese, our new state's attorney, Brian DeLeonardo, all of our municipality law enforcement, our fire and EMS, to provide them with the tools needed to deliver efficient and effective service, we'll maintain our status as one of the safest counties in Maryland. We have an amazing history of volunteerism in Carroll and are especially fortunate to have wonderful, talented volunteers in fire and EMS, which I have worked very hard to preserve. Public service is something that I have always respected, and we must plan ahead to maintain all of these critical services in a way that's as efficient and cost-effective as possible. I will also be leading the charge to create a work group to tackle our enormous drug problem, which is not only an issue in Carroll, but across the state. We will be organizing a drug summit in February to develop both a short and long-term plan to attack the issues, including enforcement, treatment, education, and prevention. Sheriff DeWeese has already added an additional drug investigator to the Carroll County Drug Task Force. In closing, my commitment to work for you as I embark on my first year in office and the importance of these three E's can be summed up with this quote from Henry Ford. Coming together is a beginning. Keeping together is progress. Working together is success. I look forward to working with all of you. There are many advisory board openings as we speak, and I encourage any of you to check those out and apply and be a part of the process for our healthy local economy. Thank you very much for listening to my brief presentation this morning. And again, we look forward to working with all of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Wantz. Our next commissioner representing District 2 and serving as Board Secretary, Commissioner Richard Weaver.
Good morning. I walked in here this morning and I was talking to Peggy at the desk and I said, "What's playing?" She said, "A comedy." I can't give that speech today, but I want to thank you for the Chamber of Commerce for hosting this event. It's an honor and privilege to be here. After attending the Maryland Association of Counties and talking to other elected officials from counties throughout the state, I was always proud and humbled to represent my home. Through hard work, shared vision, and cooperation, Carroll continues to be a strong county. I am very optimistic and encouraged for our county's future. One primary area of focus regards farmland preservation. As our new master plan is presented, we must achieve balance between economic development, residential development, and preserving our farmland. Carroll County is comprised of 289,000 acres. Approximately 132,000 acres currently are in agriculture. This ground generates $112 million per year in Carroll County. We also remain number 3 in state in dairy production. Carroll County has set a goal of assuring that our agricultural heritage will remain strong. To accomplish this goal, 100,000 acres is to be placed in a preservation program by 2020. At present, we have preserved approximately 67,000 acres. 100,000 acres devoted solely to agriculture will remain a strong balance for future generations. These preservation programs are being used by beginning farmers and for the expansion of our present farming operations. Carroll County is a leader in the state and nationally in its preservation of farmland. We are currently under the direction of Ms. Deb Bowers, who has taken the helm behind Ralph Robertson and Bill Powell. These three people are continuing to promote and achieve our goal. They have been fantastic. This is the only county program that is clearly defined by long-range goal of this magnitude. Another primary area of focus is our education system. Carroll County has been and will continue to be one of the top school systems in the state. A strong, established, consistent school system has a positive trickle-down effect on all aspects of the communities. One of the primary reasons we all work so hard for the betterment of Carroll is because we want to continue to have a safe, successful, fruitful home to raise our families. One of the first questions a new business will ask when coming to the county, what is the state of the school system? I was part of the school system for 38 years and have a deep understanding of what it takes to build and maintain a stellar school. You cannot walk through a school for 30 minutes and possibly hope to fathom how a school system works on a regular basis. The dedication of our teachers has been and continues to be unparalleled, but they need support. Our buildings are excellent compared to many areas of the country. However, they require constant updating and maintenance. Our student population can and does compete with students anywhere in the country, but this is not a one-time goal to reach or a finish line to cross. We must dedicate ourselves to maintaining this level of excellence we all have worked so hard to achieve. We must continue to provide our school system with the most up-to-date tools, skills, and technologies to provide our students with the best education we possibly can. The Board of Commissioners and the new Board of Education have agreed to start having quarterly joint board meetings. We will allow both boards to work together proactively and continually to meet the needs of our education programs. Finally, we must never forget the absolute necessity of a strong united police force. We have a very real drug problem threatening this county. One has continued to affect our communities and families. Our police force works tirelessly to keep our citizenry safe, but it cannot possibly hope to do all they can without the continued trust and support of the community. During my campaign, I said it was not my job to think for you. It's my job to work with you. We will continue to work together to build and maintain Carroll County, the Carroll County that we call home. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Weaver. Next is Commissioner Dennis Frazier, representing District 3.
Thank you and good morning. Having only been in office for about 5 weeks or so, there's not a lot that I can talk about the state of the county and what has transpired over the past year. However, I can say that I've been motivated and even inspired by the county workers that I've interacted with in that short time. They do whatever is necessary to get their jobs done and still have time to answer all my questions, and I have many. There's one item that I have checked off my list of issues that I said I would work on when I was elected, and that's the Educational Opportunity Fund. I'm happy to tell you that the taxpayers of Carroll County would not be putting any additional money into that fund for the upcoming budget year. I would like to take a minute to talk about economic development. I know the county has been making great strides in bringing in more businesses and working with existing companies to expand, and it is paying off. As many of you know, a high-speed fiber optic system is the cornerstone of what I believe is essential for even more development. We have just approved $1.3 million to upgrade the current system so the edge devices on the fibers could handle even more information because the demand for data is ever increasing. We're currently looking at ways to build that last mile of fiber that will connect the fiber backbone we already have in place to the business and industrial parks in the county, similar to what the City of Westminster is now doing. Businesses want this, and we need to do this so Carroll County can attract and keep more business. This will create more jobs in the county, which means more money for the county. Money not just in the form of taxes, but also from leasing the fiber network out to a third-party provider. The more high-tech, small-footprint business we attract, the better. Carroll County is a great place to live and raise a family. We just need more places where we can also work. Speaking of a great place to raise a family, we just had a Law Enforcement Appreciation Day, where it was noted that Carroll County has the lowest crime rate of any place in the state. When you look at the low crime rate, along with the great school system and available inventory of business sites, Carroll County is ready and able to support new business. Bring them on. As the budget process begins, I will not forget that one of the major planks of my platform was making Carroll County salaries competitive with surrounding counties. I have had enough of Carroll County training workers for other jurisdictions. I will work to keep our best workers in our county. But please remember, this will not be a quick process, as the budget has many items that must already be funded. I will keep the county employees' plight in mind when making all budgetary decisions. And to that end, in my mind, nothing is off the table when it comes to finding revenue or reallocating what we already have. Because if we keep doing what we have done in the past, we'll keep ending up in the same situation that we are right now. I don't want that, and I don't think you do either. But give the new board time. I'm confident help is on the way. Another issue I talked about when running for county commissioner was trying to work with other commissioners on issues that affect Carroll County and working with Annapolis for our common good. With the past election, there is new leadership in Carroll County and across the state. I look forward to working with the new leaders in Annapolis and in our county and finding solutions that are best interest of Carroll County. For the most part, we, the commissioners, are working together on Carroll County issues. To be sure, we have not agreed on everything. However, most of the disagreements have been helpful toward finding solutions to the problems. Discussion brings more facts to light so better solutions can be made. In that vein, I look forward to more discussion and even disagreement. However, I know that when people are working together toward common goals, great things can be accomplished, and I'm hoping for great things from this board. In closing, I'd like to say, this job of the government to serve the people, and not the job of the people to serve the government. I thank you for your time. Look forward to serving you in the next 4 years.
Thank you, Commissioner Frazier. And representing District 4, Commissioner Richard Rothschild.
Good morning. I want to tell you a true story. This actually happened Thursday night of last week. I was at the Maryland Association of Counties meeting talking to Secretary Hall, and it was a dog-friendly hotel, so we were talking about dogs. We were kidding around, and I said, yeah, Mr. Secretary, I told my son, you know, don't get married to someone that doesn't like dogs. And the secretary says to me, he says, well, Commissioner, I have a question for you. Suppose your son can't decide between two different people. One is a woman who is a Republican who doesn't like dogs, and the other is a Democrat that does like dogs. What are you going to tell him? I thought about it a second. I said, it's simple, Mr. Secretary. It depends on whether or not the dog's a Republican. You know, repeating something that is false over and over again doesn't make it true. Many things are often misrepresented in the media, so today I want to set the record straight on some important issues. Number one, the Clean Chesapeake Coalition and the rain tax. Last year, naysayers accused the commissioners of wasting legal fees, and I quote, on ambulance-chasing attorneys because we pay dues to this coalition. Let's set the record straight. Last year, I talked about the Clean Chesapeake Coalition of Counties. You saw satellite photos of 19 million tons of sediment entering the bay from the Conowingo Dam during a storm. The sediment settles to the bottom of the bay where it smothers the oyster beds, smothers the submerged aquatic vegetation, essentially killing the bay from the bottom up. Using facts, we prove the rain tax would have a negligible effect on the bay compared to the damage caused by sediment from the dam. Carroll's refusal to levy a rain tax, coupled with extensive coverage on radio and television, helped discredit bad policies from Annapolis and reshape public opinion. In fact, because of our testimony, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission has now refused to relicense the dam until they better understand the sediment problem. Did you know that several of the environmental speaking points adopted by our new governor were actually developed by the Clean Chesapeake Coalition? And now under Governor Hogan, we have hope for more affordable solutions and a cleaner Chesapeake, and hopefully our farmers and businesses will no longer be used as scapegoats for flawed environmental policies. Issue number two, planning. Time and again, citizens tell me they moved here to escape the urbanization of surrounding counties. In 2010, citizens rebelled against the unpopular pathways plan that would have transformed the fabric of our rural county. So let's set the record straight. We don't need a crystal ball to know what our citizens want. They want to preserve our rural agricultural heritage. They do not want mass transit. They do not want subsidized housing. They do not want farming sacrificed for urbanization, and they resent insulting comments from Carroll 2030 that infer they are closed-minded or bigoted. That's right, it's in there. There's a saying, he who has the gold makes the rules. Well, in government, he who picks the work group members determines the outcome. If I staff a work group with 20 pro-Chevrolet guys, it should be no surprise when they magically come back with a recommendation to buy more Chevys. Did they vote? Yes. Was a democratic process employed? Yes. But the outcome was predestined from the beginning. You know, Thomas Jefferson said he was no friend of energetic government. It is always oppressive. When an appointed panel akin to Carroll 2030 presumptuously demands energetic government, promotes mass transit, advocates urbanization, and overtly insults our citizens, it is detestable. If our citizens truly want more urbanization, they would simply move to Baltimore or Montgomery County, but it is not what they want. Of course, creating a pro-business environment is essential, but it is equally important that we preserve the rural heritage that makes Carroll, Carroll. So what's next? Bylaws that called for official adoption provide irrefutable proof that 2030 was not just a brainstorming session. It was a planning group that is now attempting to legitimize closed meeting decisions after the fact. This is not good government. When energetic government runs astray, leadership requires officials with the conviction and courage to steer the ship of state back on course to protect our citizens' rights. During the past 4 years, we stopped pathways, defended the First Amendment and the proper role of God in government, stopped the rain tax, and said no to illegal immigration, while spending only 25% of our total legal budget for the 4 years. Carroll County stood firm in the face of adversity. We did not waver, and we prevailed on many epic issues. As we enter 2015, I pray this new Board of Commissioners will build upon the foundations laid by the previous board that made Carroll County a shining beacon of hope across Maryland and across America. Thank you, and may God bless Carroll County.
Thank you, Commissioner Rothschild. And finally, from District 5 and serving as the President of the Board of Commissioners, Commissioner Doug Howard.
The difficulty with a prepared speech is you tend not to want to go off track, but I do want to point out three things. First of all, I do like Chevys very much. Second of all, I think we just witnessed what Carroll County citizens want to see least in their government. And third, there are clearly worse things than getting up and singing. Good morning, everyone. I want to thank the Chamber for having us here today, for hosting this event, for the Carroll Arts Center for hosting this event, for the sponsor of M&T Bank, and I also want to thank the class of 2015, Leadership Carroll Class of 2015, for allowing us to participate in your local government day. I hope you will be the next best class to the class of 2003, which was clearly the best class ever produced. I was in that class. It is my pleasure to be here for what is my fifth State of the County address. I'm excited to be here with my new colleagues who bring an energy, experience, and new ideas to our board and our community, and yes, to our existing commissioners that came back, because it is time for us to work together. In this time of great promise, we build on the successes of the past, work with new leaders across our county, and see the dawning of a new administration in Annapolis. I proudly report that the state of our county is strong, we are financially sound, we remain among the best in the state on most key indicators, and we are showing great improvement in areas that are most needed, particularly economic development, where we have clearly moved the needle both with large companies and with entrepreneurship. And now it is time for this board to get busy, to pick up the pace, to make some decisions, dig into the budget, and get to work. Budgets are still a challenge, and they will be tight. The state budget is an absolute mess, and we don't know how that will impact us. Tough choices must be made, and all of our plans will be limited and our desires will be tempered by budget realities. But I am confident that we will see no consideration of increasing taxes. The real challenge for this board is not how strong we are today or showing the immediate short-term signs of good government like a debt reduction here or a tax cut there. The success of this board must be measured by how well we prepare the county for 10, 15, 20 years from now to meet the needs of a growing community, maintaining services, and still achieving excellent school performance, low crime rate, growing home values, keeping our rural community, maintaining infrastructure, and keeping a competitive business environment, all while maintaining our excellent quality of life. The success of this board will be defined and determined not only by what we do, but by the way we do it. Our success will depend on putting aside the distracting and self-destructive drama, personal attacks, and political division, and replacing them with new ideas, partnership, cooperation, and effectiveness. In the area of public safety, there is no bigger challenge that we face than the issue that was already mentioned this morning, the scourge of drugs in our community. I will ask this Board of Commissioners, in partnership with the new sheriff and state's attorney and many key agencies, to fully support an aggressive and properly funded retaliatory effort on illegal drugs. This will require the commitment of nearly $1 million per year over the next several years, but it is absolutely essential if we are going to go forward as a successful community to get the drugs right now. In education, we must properly fund education and yet demand more from it. We must improve teacher compensation and move forward with school technology, upgrading systems, including the schedule of schools' upgrades and replacements. We must abandon the cash and carry mentality of the past 4 years and realign community investment with long-term needs. We can do this while continuing on a path of debt reduction, but not on a path of debt elimination. We must also stop the very divisive, destructive, and embarrassing effort to divide our county into public school kids and private school kids and homeschool kids. It is not good for our community, and it is the lowest and most cynical type of politics. Therefore, I will ask our Board of Commissioners to reconsider, to relook at this whole issue in the wake of things that I think that we can do with an education fund that is truly a matching fund like we do with other nonprofits, a program through the library system to support kids that are homeschooled through some resources there, and yes, while doing that, all agreeing to fully fund education. Divide and conquer is not what Carroll County is all about, and it is not the way we should be addressing something as important as education. Education funding will also require some new and imaginative thinking by our Board of Education. We've got to strike a new balance between compensation for those teaching and the infrastructure needs that we have. I still believe that the most important thing in education is an excellent teacher at the front of that classroom who is motivated and properly trained. To this, we must all be fully committed. Regarding infrastructure, we must continue to commit to roads, utilities, and broadband to bring the resources needed to continue to develop economically, but also to provide for our citizens. And this will be the board that needs to come up with a solution, a long-term solution for solid waste. We must complete our master plan, because it is not a plan if it just keeps going and going and going, and we need to pass a freedom plan sometime in the next 4 years, because that growth area is also long overdue for planning. We must also build on the ideas of a long-term needs assessment for our community. And yes, look at the work that was done by the excellent group of folks that came together under the moniker of Carroll 2030 for long-term planning and the things that we are going to need down the road. This is not an easy task, but it is necessary for us now to put aside silly political bickering, needless drama, and wild conspiracy theories. We can instead come together with a good exchange of ideas and a cooperative spirit that is indicative and reflective of Carroll County. And in particular, I believe that one of my fellow commissioners might be surprised to learn that many of the ideas and suggestions that have come up through the myriad of discussions that we had when this group asked for public input and sought a public place, I think actually add to the work that was being done and could have been suggested all along. Therefore, I will ask our board to work with the Planning Commission to create a long-term needs assessment work group that will start from scratch, that will enjoy a more structured and public process, that will respect the community leaders and the cluster structure that came out of the 2030 process, that will leave us with 7 voting members balanced by 10 community members to raise the level of understanding and consideration for the needs that we have long-term in the community. There is a way to do this. We need to put the silliness aside and just figure out how to come up with a long-term plan. But I will tell you, if you look at the amount of money it's going to take just to provide the level of service that we are providing today, when you look at the growth that's expected by our planning department over a 20-year period of time, the needs are greater than the resources, and there is no year where we're going to have this tremendous windfall for some board to say, ah, this is when we will catch up. Carroll County has fallen behind in the past, and it was only the surge of the housing industry that allowed us to catch up. We cannot afford to do that again, so therefore, we need to be making difficult choices now. We need to have community leaders talking to each other about using facilities jointly now. We need to set the course for the things that we're going to need, because if we do not, Carroll County will not be this kind of a place. It will not have the resources and quality of life that we have as we go into the future. So together with clear goals in mind, building on partnerships in Carroll and across the state, leading our rural coalition, engaging a new administration, and fueled by ongoing success in economic development, we will translate strength today into success for our county tomorrow. That is the charge of this Board of Commissioners. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Howard, and thanks to all of you for keeping your comments on target and brief. We're right on track. Thank you so much. It's now time for questions and answers. Are there any of the sheets, has anybody filled out any additional sheets that want to be passed to the aisleway? If we can somehow gather those, if there are any. Otherwise, if you have a question, we're going to ask you to please stand, speak clearly and loudly. Commissioner Howard, I understand that if there's a general question, you're going to decide who answers that question?
Well, that sounds like way too much power for me.
All right. Well, we'll see how that goes. Any questions from the floor? It's hard for me to see up here, so just stand and... Yes.
Well, I'll be happy to start and let everybody join in. Crime is something you have to keep a very close eye on. I do think there's been an editorial shift in the mindset of the Carroll County Times when some changes happened in their organization. The front page of the paper did start to really focus much more on some of the criminal activities and negative aspects of what was going on in our community. We would be silly not to recognize the fact that we have significant concerns there. I think the citizens have recognized that. And a very big part of what we need to do is support the efforts of a new state's attorney, a new sheriff, keep the dialogue going, make sure they're working well with local law enforcement. These are not challenges that will take care of themselves, but I do believe that right now, with the right resource put behind it, we have a manageable task, but not if we don't address it, starting with this budget and this year.
Sheriff DeWeese was kind enough to come into my office about 2 weeks ago and discuss plans that he had to deal with this problem. I thought his plans were insightful. I thought they were strong. And I feel confident that we're going to get ahead of this. So thank you, Sheriff.
Like I said, I have confidence in the Sheriff's Department and the State's Attorney's Office to handle this problem. But when you look at the article that was in the Carroll County Times, you have to realize the source of the article. It was generated by a security company that went to sell security systems to homeowners. Therefore, they're trying to paint this in the worst light possible so they can sell the product. You have to keep that in mind when you read the article.
I have a great deal of confidence in the new state's attorney and the sheriff's department and the municipal police to make changes. You will see some major changes coming. It's going to be slow. But I have a great deal of confidence in what we're doing and the drug summit, we're going to make some changes in this county.
And again, for me, it would be just repetition. I agree with my four colleagues here. And I'm very much looking forward to the fact that with our new sheriff and our new state's attorney that you're going to see an influx of new energy there as we bring everyone together, including all of the municipalities and the health departments and the schools and the colleges, to be able to combat this on a level where we concentrate on education. Not only education of our citizens, but the education of ourselves as we sit around the table to come to some good decisions on how we're going to move forward. So I think that the fact that we've got some new leaders in place is a huge positive as we move to combat this effort. So certainly looking forward to working with all of them.
All right, thank you. Any other questions from the audience? I do have one that was turned in. Carroll County's unemployment rate is hovering near 5%, better than the state average, but still considerably higher than pre-2008 figure of 3.2%. Are there continuing efforts to assist long-term unemployed, and what new efforts are in the works?
I'll make a comment on that. One of the unspoken heroes in government for both this Board of Commissioners and the last Board of Commissioners was two gentlemen, John Weekman and Jack Lyburn. And when it comes to attracting large employers that need large amounts of space, 100,000 square feet and up, I'd like to tell people, I don't know anybody in the business that's more savvy and more knowledgeable about commercial real estate and relocating businesses than Jack Lyburn. He's done a tremendous job. We've got many new employers that have come into Carroll County, especially at the area of the airport. Commissioner Howard has done some good work over at Warfield, and so did prior Commissioner Roush, who's in the audience. So I think that as we continue to work that, I think we'll continue to see the unemployment rate continue to trail downwards.
I think it's important for people to realize that over the last 4 years in particular, the successes that we've had in economic development have been in spite of some real challenges of the business climate in the state of Maryland. And so when we're looking to attract companies here from other jurisdictions, other states, we have to get over that hurdle first. So we're very encouraged by some of what we're expecting out of the new administration, some of the new appointments to make the business climate more attractive, because if Maryland's tide rises, we know Carroll County will do better than its share and we'll build on the successes that we've had. But I do agree with Commissioner Rothschild that a great deal of our success over the last 4 years has been the hard work of those two gentlemen and the partners in the Carroll Business Path as well. And it's always important to remember, as Commissioner Wantz pointed out, education is still the largest driver of why businesses come here, and when businesses come here, they bring jobs. So,
okay. You know, when the business looks at Carroll County, they're looking at a good education system. They look for a good workforce. They look for a good tax structure for their workers to move here. But we also have people in this county through the Career and Tech Center, through all of our academic programs here that are really a fantastic workforce. I think you're going to see improvement here locally. I have some ideas, and I know the board here has some ideas, working with Mr. Wheaton and Jack Lyburn to maybe make some really good changes here or bring some business in. But we also have entrepreneurs here in the county that need help and structure to help pull some of this people into the workforce. We do have a good structure. Burke works hard on getting people assigned to or in touch with jobs. And I see the workforce or this rate even going down lower in the next year or two with a little help from the economy. We've inherited a bad situation somewhat here in the county, but not terrible. And you look at throughout the state how things are going, we are in good shape in Carroll County. I see this rate going down. We also have the community college willing to put in all kinds of programs to help train workforce from any company out here. They're willing to create training for these jobs. So I am optimistic about this rate being lowered.
I'd just like to comment that if you look at the work that the nonprofits are doing with the long-term unemployed, They're working with them, giving them job skills, send them to the Burke Center, trying to hook them up with employers and so forth. If it wasn't for their work, our unemployment rate wouldn't be 5%. I think we need to support them more so they could do a better job of what they're doing.
And to wrap all of that up, I can assure you when I first began to put together my address that I gave to you this morning, two of the first people that I reached out to were John Wheatman and Jack Lyburn. And again, I'll reiterate what I said. We have a tremendous staff, many of which are seated in the audience today. And they are two of our shining examples of how if we all work together, we can certainly make an impact here. And there are so many things that are going on behind the scenes to enhance our ability to get folks hired. And as several have said, our school system, our career tech center, I had the opportunity to tour the Department of Social Services a few weeks back and look at their large room that is dedicated to assisting folks that need help with hiring. So there are many ways in which we can do that, and I'm quite certain that you will see a lot of progress there as we move forward.
Okay, any other questions? Yes, in the center.
As a point of clarification, Carroll County funding is up $21 million from 6 years ago. It is the state funding which is down $21 million, yielding a pretty much flat total revenue for the school system over the last 4 years or so. But as you've already said, enrollment is declining. So in the absence, there's only two options here. If revenue goes up, then clearly we can solve the revenue problem. By funding you more, but if revenue doesn't go up, then I still believe we need to look at the infrastructure costs of the school system and consider making some, doing a little fine tuning to better reflect the actual population. We were originally sized for 31,000 students, and right now we're down to about 26,000 students. Thank you.
You know, this is going to be a very tough question, but we're not in this by ourselves. We have the state delegation working with us. We have the Board of Education working with us, and the commissioners working with these two groups. We're going to have to make some decisions. There's not a great answer that we can come up with on this, but together, three-prong attack, we're going to look at how we can fund schools the best we possibly can in the future. We know we need that. We're going to have to set priorities. What are our priorities? And we're going to together go through this process, not just dictate or try to dictate to the school board or the school board dictate to the commissioners what they need. We're going to work through this. We're going to start meeting jointly. Then we're going to start working. I think when we get this year's budget straight, we need to start working immediately on the next year, 2 years, 3 years. So we all have some long-range plans on what we need, what we can expect. We don't want any surprises for anyone.
I think we have to work with the school board, let them know what our plans are so they can plan down the road. But ultimately, I think we have to put more money in education.
Okay. Sure. I think this is a short answer here. With no disrespect to previous boards, I am truly optimistic about the fact that we are going to see a much increased communication avenue here with the two boards working together. And certainly the fact that we will be able to have a good working relationship, I think you will see some progress here, or I don't think, I know you will, in the success of moving forward. It's all about communication, which I think has been lacking previously. So I'm very optimistic about the fact that working together will create some great planning down the road.
And I would just add that, you know, I think one of the difficulties when we approach this issue is we essentially approach it in an annual discussion. Now, our county has a five-year operating budget, and that's critically important. But I truly believe when the Board of Education looks at our five-year budget, they look at that with the strong hope and desire that that is a worst-case scenario, not what we plan to do. We got to fundamentally look at how we're structuring things over the long term. This is probably the single biggest area where something like long-term planning becomes very important. Not that we don't understand the objectives or that we're insulting anybody's intelligence by saying that, but saying, well, how do you get there? Because you just don't get there overnight. So part of the discussions that come out of leaders of the community getting together are things like, well, we have a career and tech center that needs to be rehabbed, but we also have needs in the community college for adult education. Are there cooperative efforts that we can make to build one building instead of two down the road? If we're going to build a school, which has been talked about somewhere between Charles Carroll and Westminster, does that school need to have a library annex? Because, you know, we really don't have a library presence up there, but by the same token, we don't want to build a $15 or $20 million library 10 years from now. These are the kinds of conversations. If we just continue down the path and try to keep squeezing that rock tighter and tighter, you know, we can hope that that will generate some results, and maybe a rising economy will do some things. All those pieces contribute. We need to start thinking about things differently. We also are going to have to think about the way we finance things. You cannot pay cash for everything and have the resources to pay teachers. The other thing is really everybody's got to come to the table, hat in hand, and take up for what got us into this situation. And it was no one group of people. It wasn't just the Board of Commissioners. But by the same token, it wasn't just the state. Part of it was the Board of Education. We've all made decisions that have led us here. If we weren't paying state teacher pensions, if that hadn't been shifted to us, there'd be lots of money there, $8, $9, $10 million that could go into the kind of funding that we need for operations. If we hadn't built in advance of state funding a high school that didn't qualify for state funding, we would have more money there. If we didn't make some other decisions along the way, there would be more resources there. The problem is you can't undo 7, 8, 10 years of decisions with one budget. And I believe this year is the year with a new board, with some new folks on the Board of Education, with a new administration in Annapolis, this is the year to sit down and spend a little bit more time saying, yes, we got to get through this budget, but sometime maybe over the course of this summer or the fall, we have got to come up with a comprehensive plan that puts everything on the table. Otherwise, all we're going to do is create the false hope that someday the heavens are going to open up and that money is going to fall into the education budget. And I'm concerned that that just is not going to happen.
Okay. Yes, in the back.
I think actually what we're seeing is that the market is responding in great measure to that. One of the things that was a little bit of a consternation for former Commissioner Roush and myself was that as we were going through the Warfield project, we saw that as purely a business project. We wanted a corporate park and expected that to be the evolution of that endeavor. As things went forward, both market pressures for housing of varying kinds from the private sector, not government-funded, but from the private sector, were out there. And at the same time, that demand was in excess of what the rates were for taking on commercial space. So when the folks that came in with a significant investment in this property said, if you want us to make this work,
we're going to have some combination here. We're going to have some townhouses. They're going to be very nice. They're going to be consistent with the county. But we need more flexibility in your thinking about the project, because the market is telling us this is what's needed. That's what we ended up with there. And I think we're going to see more and more. We've seen other projects kind of popping up around. That's probably going to be the best way to address it. But I think we're hearing from folks that that is a challenge, and you can see it. I mean, frankly, the significant part of Carroll County, the part that I live in, is evacuating every morning to jobs in other counties, but they live up here. By the same token, in the north part of the county, right, if you come down 97, you have folks that are working here but have gone over the Pennsylvania line to live. So at the very least, we're going to have to widen some roads if we don't figure out the housing issue. But I think the market is starting to address that.
Yeah, we have to be. My one. We have to be careful not to presume that government has the solutions. And I'll give you an example of why. I mean, in Carroll County, with interest rates being 3 or 4%, you can buy a single-family home in the $250,000 price range for, you know, $1,000-$1,200 a month. If you go down to Montgomery County, which has wholeheartedly embraced smart growth, a three-bedroom apartment can easily rent for $1,400-$1,500. So we need to also be careful about assuming the government has a solution to this problem. Usually the market-driven solutions are the best.
I'll attempt just to wrap, and I agree with both of the previous comments. I live that coming down 97 every morning, and I can assure you that is certainly on the radar. And I also live it because I'll put a personal touch to this. I've got a daughter with a master's degree in education and a son-in-law with a good job, and they're struggling with the housing market here in Carroll. So we're going to put a lot of emphasis on that. And again, I don't want to keep harping on communication, but I think that's truly important. It is my intent to work with the realtors and the bankers of Carroll to be able to come up with reasonable ideas here to try to move forward to help these not only young people but all of the folks that are struggling. So that certainly is on our radar, and we're gonna do everything that we can to try to address that situation. So I know that's not a clear cut answer, but again, as those of us that have just walked in to a lot of the issues here and have been in office for a little bit, there's a lot on our plate. But we certainly are trying to get to each of those as quickly as we can. And I want to emphasize that by working together, we can make some good strides here with some of these things.
Very quickly.
Free enterprise, less government intervention, things will work out if we work together. Short and sweet.
Okay. Yes, in the back, way back.
4 years ago, I listened to five people come together on stage and talk about the great hope for our county. Same words I'm hearing now. I left here very excited. Now my wife will not allow me to turn on Channel 24 in the house anymore. There was so much infighting, so much politics. I want to go back, I believe it was you, Commissioner Wantz, that talked about for the citizens. I want you to think about that. And I'd like you to change your name naturally from the Fighting 15-9, certainly, which was prophetic. Even though many good things were done, I'd like to see more of the United 60. Thank you.
Let me just say one thing. You don't want us too united, because I'll tell you, when you have five commissioners, you want to see public discourse. Now, it doesn't have to be personal. It doesn't have to be nasty. But I will tell you what, the one thing I am proudest of, there is no one that can accuse this board, or the prior board, really, of not having open discussions about issues very publicly. And I will tell you, across the country, and we've seen a good example just in the last couple of days of some decisions that were made in very secretive, closed-door manner. You want to see these decisions. We need that in our situation. We need it in our Board of Education. We need it in all of our boards and associations and organizations that are out there that are publicly making decisions. Now, the tone and acrimony, and I've been as guilty of it as anybody, or at least one of the top contenders, there's a certain amount of, you kind of forget you're on television, and you kind of forget that, not everything lives and dies by the next issue. And I think that we can do a much better job with that. But don't ever look for the possibility that you don't have good public discourse, because you won't get good public policy.
I agree 100% with Commissioner Howard. I've heard historians look back at the Bay of Pigs incident with John Kennedy, and they said one of the reasons we got into that mess was because of groupthink. Everybody was just going along to get along. And the fact of the matter is, while it may be painful sometime, and I'm guilty also, and I respect Commissioner Howard for also sharing responsibilities with me, but the fact of the matter is, some level of controversy, some level of debate, some level of opposition is not necessarily a bad thing. It can lead to better policies. It can lead to refinement. Even today up here, Commissioner Howard made some announcements he had not made before, and I think as a direct result of some of the conflict we've had over some other policy issues, and I believe the outcomes will ultimately be better for the people of Carroll County. So don't be afraid of debate. It can be good.
I like to say I don't mind discussion and debate or even controversy over some of the things that we're talking about, as long as it, number one, doesn't get personal. We keep ourselves to the debate or discussion of the topic that we're talking about. Once we make a decision, we move on. We don't go back and revisit it. We have decisions made, let's move on with it. I mean, if we don't have discussion, debate, I don't think a lot of things will be brought to light. The more we talk about it, sometimes the more things come out, and we see things at from a different angle. However, having said that, discussing just for the fact of slowing down what the board is doing is counterproductive. If there's something that actually needs to be said, that's good. But if you're just saying something to slow us down so we don't make a decision, so we want to put something off to the next meeting or the meeting after that or whatever, it's not productive for the board. We won't get much done that way. Thank you.
I agree with Commissioner Frazier, and one of the stands I took running for this office is we are going to work together to accomplish the goals for Carroll County, and I do stand by that. I agree with everything you said, Kurt, and I think this is our charge is to work together as commissioners for the betterment of Carroll County.
It is my intent, and I have said this for the last 2 years, to represent all of Carroll County in the best manner that I can. Debate is healthy. Difference is healthy. But if all of us can come together in the end with a good decision moving forward, regardless of who thinks what, I think you will see a much quicker ability to come to a good decision. I will also tell all of you that one of the things that I have seen in the first however many weeks we've been in office, the fact that, and I've heard it time and time again, and it's amazing to me how many questions and issues that the constituents bring up. I had no idea that there would be as many as what there is. And the mere fact that you get back to these folks and give them an answer or acknowledge the fact that they do have a question has been priceless. So I think you will see, and knowing the five or the other four here, that knowing them like I do, and remember, we're coming together here not only as commissioners and learning how we're going to work together, but as individuals and learning the personal traits here as we move forward. And I'm very optimistic to this point that I truly believe that you'll see a different attitude here as we move forward.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
Seems to be stalling some growth. So my question, and I understand that some of the resolutions, my understanding is that are kind of getting lost in maybe some of the bureaucratic processes within the state system. So my question is, What can the commissioners do to work with the municipalities and the state to perhaps help navigate that bureaucracy and forward these possible resolutions that seem to be stalling growth in our county?
That's a great question. You know, I understood the idea of, you know, searching for gold and searching for oil. Until I got into office, I didn't understand the idea of searching for water in quite the profound way that that it affects our county. It would be wrong to think that this hasn't been a priority. This has been a huge priority. And, you know, certainly the city of Westminster in particular has worked very closely in partnership with the county commissioners. And I think you'll see over the next year or two, things that have been in the works for some time are going to come to some measure of fruition. So we're excited about how proactive they've been. The other really issue, though, is, and it's one that really affects us not only in this issue but other issues as it relates to the state, is this notion of state regulation. And really, when you look at our water and water supply, it's not that we don't have water. It's that the regulation has allowed us to only use certain percentages of that water, you know, in anticipation of the 100-year drought or whatever other regulations they may apply. So the expectation is, particularly with the new administration, that we're going to be able to address those issues because they're not unique to Carroll, although we are certainly on the forefront of that battle. We do belong to a rural coalition of counties. We were one of the founding members. It started with four counties. It is now at 11 and soon to be, I think, about 13, 14. So we're combining with other counties to have a much more concerted effort and a stronger voice in Annapolis. But at the end of the day, you know, I think if you look at what we did with the permitting process that we just went through with the municipalities, which was sort of a landmark step, when we go forward with any of these discussions, and I know we have some discussions coming up soon, I think even this week, we need to have the mayors at the table, the city planners and city managers, town managers at the table, because isolated solutions to these problems just aren't going to get it. That is a big part of, I think, where the results are going to come from. But I think there's probably a lot more that can be done, and I think you're going to see some of that over the next couple of years.
I'll add a few more pieces to the equation. We have been drilling for water. We actually drilled up at Union Mills, but I don't believe any of our drilling yielded any measurable results or significant results. So part of it is a natural resource limitation. As Commissioner Howard just said, part of it is regulatory. I believe our well yields are limited to 50% of capacity. But there's a third thing you need to be aware of. Even within the county, and it varies within districts, you know, this issue of more public water becomes two sides of the same coin. If you're a business, if you're living in a municipal town, you probably want more public water. It certainly enables more development. But there's the other half of the population that says we don't want large-scale water supplies because it'll lead to more development, because large-scale water supplies are what enables dense housing developments, be they apartment houses, condominiums, et cetera. And believe it or not, I'll speak about my district. I won't speak for the other commissioners' districts. You know, we're based primarily on large lot development, on well and septic, and people in District 4 like it that way. So when I talk to them about developing other water supplies, such as Gillis Falls, I get a viscerally negative reaction from many of the homeowners down there. So understand, the county itself is not in unison on this issue.
Well, I know from being a past councilman for the city of Westminster that when the city went to the Maryland Department of Environment to try to get some wells okayed and so forth, it takes a long time to get that done. I mean, one of the wells, I won't go into anything else, Mayor, I was just saying, but we've been looking at it for about 2 years to try to get it okayed by the Maryland Department of Environment, and it still hasn't been okayed yet. And that well is, I believe, like 200,000 gallons a day that would produce, and we don't have the okay from Maryland Department of Environment. I think a united front from the commissioners and the municipalities going there might help us out. But to be frank, I don't know. We just keep getting stonewalled when we get down to Annapolis. Hopefully with the new administration, it won't be that way. But we'll have to see how it works out.
The amount of regulation is horrendous. New to office, I am appalled by the rate in which we don't move on things. But one of the things we do have to do is work together. all the towns, the commissioners, and our delegation. I do have some hope on this. We have a good line of communication started. If we can keep this going, if we can get the regulations we want completed in Annapolis that trickles back to the county, we should be in pretty good shape. And I have to agree with Commissioner Rothschild a little bit on the well situation. I think a lot of us are very independent in our thinking. If we can stay with that type system, as long as we don't pollute it, we're fine. But this is a lot of fine issues we're going to be dealing with here, but communication is going to be the key.
And I will certainly agree with that. Yesterday, I had the City of Westminster in my office, and I'm very optimistic about the things that are happening there with the water situation. Communication, that's what it's all about. And I'm quite optimistic about the fact that with the new administration in Annapolis, that we will see some relief, if you will, with the regulations. And I think that's going to go a long way in solving some of these issues.
Did you have the whole city in your office?
I had the whole city in my office.
I was afraid. I've had this ongoing fear that his office was.
You walked by at one point. You didn't see that?
Okay.
We have time for just one more question. Unless there are no more questions. All right. Thank you, Commissioners, so much. Great having you here. Thanks for your participation. We do have just a couple more pieces of business to kind of wrap up before we leave today. It comes a time in everybody's board person's life on the chamber that we have to say goodbye, and we have one person this year that's leaving the board. I know he's been a great leader. He's been a chairperson. He's really believed in what the chamber does for business here in Carroll County. It's going to be hard to see him go. We've got a tradition here where we just don't send people on their way. We give them the golden boot. So my friend, Mr. Steve Aquino, would you please come up? I'd like to give you the boot. And it is my great pleasure to relinquish the gavel to Miss Lori Blake. Lori, would you come up? 2015 chairperson for the Chamber of Commerce.
Thank you. Thanks, Mike. I'm Lori Blake, and I've met and worked with many of you during my 17-year tenure with the Carroll County Times. I'm currently the HR director at Fuchs North America, located in Owings Mills, but coming to Carroll County next year, which we're very excited about. I'm honored to serve as this year's chair and look forward to working with all of you. On behalf of the chamber and the board of directors, I'm gonna thank Mike Fox for his terrific leadership this year. I certainly have big shoes to fill. Mike, please accept this plaque as a token of our appreciation and for your service, leadership.
Thank you, Laura.
Are you going to wrap things up? Okay, it's all yours. Wind it down.
Thank you, Lori, and thank you, Mike. Mike, you're officially not the chair anymore, so now we'll always introduce you as the immediate past chair, at least for the next year. But I would like to thank Mike. It's been a great year working with him. I'd like to thank the folks over at Lehigh. They've always been a friend of ours. And Mike has been great to work with, so just give him another round of applause. It takes a lot of work to. And for Lori, I'll try not to abuse you as much as I have Mike and Steve and those people in the past. So, but I really appreciate the fact that you're going to be working with us during the course of this next year, and looking forward to working with Fuchs. So how about a round of applause for Lori? To Sandy Ox. Sandy, this place is beautiful. We love coming here, and it's fun coming here for the movies, too, and for all the stuff you guys do. So thank you once again to Sandy. Give her a round of applause. And M&T Bank, our sponsor. This is maybe like the 15th year in a row, it seems like, at least as long as I've been here, for about four and a half. that they have come alongside of us. I'm sure we'll see them here again next year. Looking forward to spending the day with our Leadership Carol class. You guys are going to have a break, and then at 9:45 you need to be upstairs, and you get to spend some time with our commissioners, kind of on a one-on-one basis, at lunch. You guys are all coming to lunch, as I understand it, at Harry's, and then you'll be here for the afternoon. Finally, to our commissioners, I'd like to thank you all for coming here. Three of you are new, two I've had a chance to work with for a while. It takes a lot of courage to do what you do. I mean, it honestly does, and I have a lot of respect for anybody who wants to do that type of a job, because it's not a, you don't get thanked a lot. Let's just put it that way. But I do have a lot of respect that each of you have a passion for what you do, and that's important. And each of you have different skills and different areas that you are actually passionate about. And I think if you work together as a team and keep that one word of respect, so when you talk to each other, when you deal with each other, that you're always trying to keep respect, which is a very Christian thing to do. And I know we talk a lot about prayer. I'm not advocating anything other than if we're going to be Christian, if we're going to be like that, having respect for one another. And I think that you'll find when people don't have respect for us, we put up a wall almost immediately. I mean, I can have somebody come up to me and say something that's exactly true, but the manner in which they say it could be meant as an attack. Up goes the wall, and I don't want to hear anything that they have to say. If you do that, you're not going to get as far as by trying to have respect for each other. And I think you guys can do a lot of great things, and there's a lot of great folks in this town that want to come alongside of you and want to work with you and want to help to make Carroll an even better place than it already is. And I love Carroll. I wasn't born here, so I'm not a native, but I've been here for about 25 years. So I've always thought that when you make the choice to move into a place, you're a little bit more of a native than those who just happen to be born here. So I have a lot. That's at least my angle. So I've got a lot vested here in Carroll, and I think you guys are going to be wonderful if you keep that word respect in your mind. So other than that, I want to thank everyone for coming and for being here with us. We will have, during the course of the year, five separate actual meetings that we'll be doing them, one in each district, where each one of our commissioners will have a chance to speak. So check out our website for that, and we'd love to have you come to that. So other than that, the meeting is adjourned. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm.